Hello and welcome to the show. This is Martin Willis, your host, and we have a great one for you this evening. A lot of people are excited about my guest. I've gotten a lot of email. It's Diana Pasulka, and she's a professor of religious studies. I'll go into more of that as the time draw nears when she's coming aboard. But right now, in just a minute, we have Alejandro Rojas joining us for UFO Updates. And I do want to tell you, next week we're going to have a new phone number, and that's through the KGRA radio. It's their paranormal radio app hotline. And so make sure you add this number to your mobile phones. It's actually 85 KGRA-live, or the real number is 855-472-5483. And these are going to be screen calls. It's all going to start next week, and we will queue, of course, when the calls are welcome, which is generally, I usually take calls in the second hour of the show. I want to thank everyone that supports the show. Anyone can do that. All you have to do is go over to podcastufo.com, and the information's over there. And speaking of information, our blog this week is UFOs and the science that the scientists that love them. And so that's a blog by Charles Lear, another great blog. We have weekly blogs at this point by Charles, does a nice job. And so I think that is going to get us started. Alejandro, how are you doing today?
Hello, I am doing good. Busy on World UFO Day.
Yeah. Is it UFO Day? I didn't know that.
It is, yeah. And I guess it commemorates the Kenneth Arnold sighting. And I even had the local NBC network was in interviewing myself and Karen about World UFO Day. So that's going to air in like an hour.
Now, how come I do a UFO show and I had no clue? That's just embarrassing. I can't believe it.
That is embarrassing.
Yeah. Wow.
You should be reprimanded by the UFO Ufologist Council.
Yeah, I know. That. Wow. Yeah, I think I just lost some ground. Oh, wow. Yeah, awesome. Well, fun. And so what else is happening?
I know, and my social media even has some goofy pictures around UFO Day. But yeah, a lot is going on. So our good buddy MJ Benias, and this is really cool. He's been getting articles in Vice about UFOs. And yeah, that's so cool that he's been able to do that. And his latest is called Meet Silicon Valley's UFO Hunters. In fact, I think he even references your guest tonight in that story.
That's right.
Diana
yeah.
Pasulka, because in her book, she was working with a Silicon Valley kind of startup, or not even startup. I think he's a venture capitalist. I'm sure she'll clear it all up, but about UFOs. And so he's kind of talking about how there are these startups and there are others that are into the topic, which is pretty interesting that, you know, people in Silicon Valley would have that interest. So it's a great article. And it ties into some other articles. In fact, there was another article by Tyler Rogaway, who we've also interviewed from the War Zone. He was examining these Navy patents. And you may ask, well, what does that have to do with UFOs and everything? Well, they're advanced theoretical physics, these patents. And what's interesting about them is Hal Puthoff, who is one of the guys who works with ATIP, with Lou Elizondo's Pentagon project. In fact, Hal Puthoff has worked with Robert Bigelow for many years. And so they were contracted to work. And there's some of these papers are theoretical physics papers are in the ATIP documents that we've seen. So that's where his root is. In fact, it's very interesting. Hal Puthoff has been working on paranormal topics with the government for decades. In fact, he was instrumental in the remote viewing project, where it was kind of a psychic project that the government had started up. He was working with Stanford and the CIA at the beginning to develop this kind of psychic ability called remote viewing. And that program went on for decades. Many suspect it still goes on. So Hal Puthoff's been around for a long time, and he's referenced in these documents. And that's kind of the tie-in with ATIP here. But what's interesting about these documents is that many feel it's kind of pseudoscience. It's so theoretical. It's not provable. It's beyond our capabilities completely. And so what he's kind of saying here is that although the patent office said, no, you know, these are just too out there, they're not even, you can't even demonstrate these technologies. But the government came back because these were submitted by a government and Navy physicist. And they said, well, actually, we're working on testing some of this stuff. It is legit. And we believe the Chinese are working on it. So they approved the patents to be reviewed, and they're in the review process now. And so they were also made public. So it was just kind of a weird story, especially because it's kind of not really stuff that can be worked on. Well, another guy who's on social media quite a bit lately, Deep Prasad, he actually wrote a Medium article on this and kind of boiled it down some more, which is helpful. And he kind of said the same thing. It's ridiculous the patent office is even looking at these things because they're really far out there. But he gave a little more context to it. So some of you may have heard Michio Kaku talk about UFOs and ETs. And he often references, I think it's called Kardashev. It's a K scale, they call it, where they call civilizations by the amount of energy they can manipulate, essentially. A type one can manipulate or harness the energy of a sun. We're not even close to a type one. We're below that. But like Deep mentions in this article, that it would take a type two civilization or more to be able to harness the technology that is theorized in these papers. And some of the papers, at least one of them, even has the science a little messed up. So he's wondering, you know, why are we even looking at this right now? His thing is kind of like, he suspects the reason why the Navy is putting out these patents, and this ties into how put off an ATIP, is because they think this is the sort of technology that they're observing with these UFOs, like in the Nimitz incident, or for those of you who have been watching Unidentified. You know, last week they reviewed the Roosevelt case where these other jet fighters encountered these objects that were like cubes inside of translucent orbs. And so he's saying that the media and science really needs to make note and take serious attention, because if the Navy is serious that they believe, you know, there are these advanced technologies beyond our abilities that are being observed, that this demonstrates that this is a big deal to the Navy and to the government. And so it should be a big deal to the general public and to the scientific community. He's essentially saying that, you know, that it demonstrates that the technology exists and is being observed. So scientists in particular should be interested in understanding the science behind them and trying to figure out what they are and who they are. And so some really interesting stuff. He kind of talks about his motivation for being all of this is kind of similar to mine. It's similar to something Commander David Fravor said. He's the guy who chased, you know, that UFO in the Nimitz event. He said, I don't know whose they are, but I would like to fly one because, yeah, that's, you know, right. They demonstrate, yeah, this amazing technology. And it's kind of the same thing. I got involved with this, and one of the things that really gets me, I started off in school wanting to be a rocket scientist, is the idea of being able to fly around and check out the universe and go explore like Star Trek or something. So, you know, it's exciting to him, and he feels it should be exciting to others that these devices or these aircraft seem to exist and somebody's flying them around.
It's almost like they're trying to reverse engineer from observation.
Exactly. That's exactly what they're doing. And that's what Bigelow has talked about doing in the past. You know, the MUFON symposium's coming up, and one of the speakers is going to be John Schussler, who is a mentor of mine. He worked at NASA. That's exactly what inspired him. Same with Bob Wood, who was an engineer, aerospace engineer, who's also a board member with MUFON. So a lot of scientists have been inspired and, you know, kind of thinking, well, maybe if all we can do is see these things and observe them, maybe there is some technology that can be gleaned from the observations. And many scientists think that's ridiculous. There's no way you can glean any science from just observations. Others disagree, such as Hal Puthoff or others who believe that they are being able to observe some of this technology in use. And to the stars, in fact, is very serious about the potential of being able to develop some of these technologies that are being observed.
Yeah. It's almost like anything really amazing, you know, starts with an idea and then, you know, they figure out how how to do whatever it is. It's just along those lines. And that's
what science is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
it's observing a phenomena and then trying to understand how that phenomena works.
Yeah. And duplicate it. Yeah. Very interesting. Anything else happening?
Let's see. There are tons of headlines. It's an exciting time because the media is taking UFOs so seriously. Mm-hmm. There are just a ton of headlines out there. So there are interviews. A new interview with Chris Mellon is out there.
That's right.
Yep. This is a really interesting survey that was done by Rasmussen, I believe is the name of the company. And there's not a lot of outlets that have picked it up. But essentially, they're a survey company, and they did a survey about people's beliefs regarding UFOs. Is it likely there's life on other planets and that sort of thing? Most people said were kind of hesitant. Now, one of the sites that broke this down is kind of a political group, so they kind of broke down. They found there wasn't much of a difference between political parties.
But interesting.
That men were more likely than women to say it was very likely that there's intelligent life on other planets, to the tune of men at 39% and women at 24%. So I found that kind of interesting. But as far as posing a threat to national security, 61% said no, 12% said yes, and 27% unsure. I think that's important because the nature of what we're hearing with these government programs is that, you know, they're seen as a threat. But it seems like the general public has not bought on to that idea. However, it's not necessarily that, you know, ATIP or Lou Elizondo is saying that these are definitively a threat. By the very nature of them being in our airspace without us knowing who they are, that's what makes them a threat, not necessarily their motivations.
So
we have to learn to be able to confirm whether or not they are. However, governments such as Chile, who has CEFA-A, which is a government-ran UFO research organization, they've actually had meetings with high-level officials to determine whether or not this is this phenomenon is a threat. And they've determined no, because they've seen so many encounters, including some similar to the Nimitz encounter, where jets are scrambled, there's kind of a cat and mouse, and then the unknown object flies off, that they haven't shown any overt sort of aggressive behavior. And so they do not feel that they are necessarily a threat. And I would say that just our own government hasn't necessarily gotten there, at least as far as we know, in assessing the motivations or the potential for a threat. But because they can label it a threat, that allows them to have these government programs and to get government funding. So it's sort of a semantics thing as well. But it is sort of interesting that right now, although this topic is becoming more popular, that the public by far does not consider the phenomena a threat. And that's probably a good thing.
Yeah.
Because I think the public would feel much more uncomfortable with the whole idea if they did perceive it as a threat.
That is so true. Yeah, it makes total sense.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's a really interesting survey out there.
Yeah. Yeah. I wonder, that's really something about the difference between men and women. And their beliefs. It's probably because women know that, you know, us men aren't that intelligent, and they don't have much help, much hope for finding more out there.
We're more intelligent species.
Yeah, that's true.
Could be very well.
Could be. Alejandro, thanks so much.
Yeah, no problem. We'll have to get. You'll have to ask Diane what her perception is of all of that. But thank you very much. Of course, you can see all of this at openminds.tv right there on the front page.
That's right. All right. I'll talk to you next week. You take care. Thank you.
All right.
All right. All right. Our guest of this evening, I'm very glad to welcome Diana Pasulka, and she is a professor of religious studies at the University of North Carolina, Wilmington, and a chair of the Department of Philosophy and Religion. And her research focuses on religion and technology. I think that's fascinating, including the supernatural belief and its connections to the digital technologies and environment. Very exciting. So welcome to the show, Diana.
Thanks. Can I go ahead and click myself in?
Okay. Yes, do that, please. Yes.
Okay, great.
All right. Yes, thanks so much for joining us.
Absolutely. My pleasure.
Yeah, it's a real pleasure. So can you tell the listening audience a little bit about yourself and how, with your background, how you got into this whole thing you've been studying?
Yeah, sure. So I grew up in California, and I went to undergraduate and graduate during the dot-com boom in the early 90s and late 90s, pretty much. You know, you spend a lot of time when you get a PhD in school. And what I did was a lot of people have misconceptions about religion. And so first off, I want to tell the audience that in the field of religious studies, what we do is I'm not a minister. We don't promote religion. We actually study it. So we study the effects of religion. In fact, someone like Jacques Vallée, when he spoke to the UN in the 1970s, he basically said, it doesn't matter, you know, whether or not UFOs or the phenomenon actually exists, belief in it exists and it is at an all-time high. So the reality, the objective reality is beside the point. So in religious studies, that's kind of our track. That's what we do. We study how people believe practices, how it affects society, how it emerges from different types of environments in society. And so what I did was I'm a Catholic historian, basically by training, and I looked at various kinds of things. I was always interested in technology, of course, because I was within the environment of Silicon Valley. I mean, I went to school California research universities right in the heart of Silicon Valley, and then I did get my PhD at Syracuse University, and so here I am in the South. And so, how did I get into studying UFOs? I've actually never seen close encounters of the third kind. I wasn't really interested in UFOs. And what happened was that I was on a normal track of being a professor and looking at the historical tradition of Christianity and Catholicism. And I did a book on the doctrine of purgatory, which for your listeners, if they don't know, is this doctrine of where souls go after they die. Catholics believe in this kind of intermediate place where if you're not good enough to get into heaven, you stay in this place and, you know, get better. Your soul gets better and then gets into heaven. And I found out that, it took me 10 years to write this book. So, wow. Yeah, it's, sometimes you have to do a lot of work to do that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So I found, you know, your research in the best of worlds should surprise you. You should be surprised by your research, and I sure was. So I found that purgatory started out as a place, as places, and there's still a purgatory cave in Ireland on this lake called Loch Derg. And people would go there in the 1200s and 1300s. And purgatory then eventually became a dogma of the Catholic Church. And people would go there and they would do, yeah. So, you know, so you can see then how religions really emerge from environments. So I wanted to really show how there was this new type of religiosity that emerged from our techno environment, our new digital infrastructure, which we are now in. And we have no clue really, you know, how it's going to play out for us. But I could tell that the belief systems of the people around me were focused on non-human intelligences and UFOs and things like that, you know, in Silicon Valley. And I also, in my research on purgatory, I came across a lot of aerial phenomena. And I started to read the work of Jacques Vallée, Passport to Magonia, read very much like my own purgatory book, in the sense that he was focusing on historical incidences of aerial phenomena. And I honestly didn't know what I was looking at the time. So I just made a log and a list of this phenomena. And I showed it to a friend of mine, and the friend looked at it and said, well, this looks like UFOs, looks like a Spielberg film. And I thought it was crazy at the time, you know, and I said, oh, you know, I kind of said, no. But there happened to be synchronistically a UFO conference in the town where I live, and I attended it, and I heard Chris Bledsoe. He lives near me, actually. And so I realized that this phenomena, the aerial phenomena, was still around. And then I did all the preliminary research on it and thought that I would go into this very easy study of a comparison between ancient aerial phenomena and contemporary aerial phenomena. And I had no clue. I was totally naive. And I got into something that, in a sense, became something way over my head. At many points, I decided I was going to stop. doing the research because it was just too weird for me. I came across the scientists, right, that you and Alejandro were talking about. And I decided that if I were going to do a book on this, that the new study would be to study them. And so I decided to immerse myself within their communities. And I Jacques Vallée became a friend, introduced me to many of them. I met many myself. I found out that there was a long-standing study that had been going on in the area in which I had lived from as a child, of people who had had experiences. And I have a brother who's Special Forces, and I also another brother who is now a captain of the police force in I won't say where, but in California. He doesn't want to, he doesn't want me to out him. But so, you know, I mean, so there were lots of phenomena, let's just put it that way, within the place where I had grown up. And I hadn't actually thought about it as UFO phenomena until 2011 and 2012. And that's really how I started my book. And I, instead of studying the experiencers, the people who actually do the, you know, I studied the people who were the scientific experiencers, and I call them the meta experiencers. And in many ways, they were what Jacques Vallée had termed and Hynek had termed the invisible college. But they're not the invisible college anymore. They're more like Fight Club, right? They're more like, we don't talk about this. So I was lucky to be involved in this group for many years, and the book emerged directly from the being, what's called ethnography, right? You kind of immersing yourself within these communities. And I just took a lot of notes and did what I did. I just kind of documented what I thought was a new type of religiosity is what we call it in my field.
Uh-huh. Wow, this is really fascinating. We got to go into a break in just just 2 minutes or so. But sure. There's also a lot of parallels in the belief systems too, isn't there? Between, you know, a lot of things created in religions. I'm just guessing because I don't have, you know, the education that you have by any means. But I mean, it seems like when there's a lot of unexplained things, like a religion would explain it in their magical or the work of God or whatever it is. So is there parallels along the lines of UFOs and creating religions being initiated?
Yes, absolutely, yes. This is basically the creation. I mean, what we're looking at is the documentation of a new form of religion that's emerging from the technology within which we live. We can't get off the grid. So we're inundated with, you know, frequencies, radiation, you know, all kinds of things that come directly from the black mirror, the screen of our phones and computers and, you know, technologies. So I'm being aware that you need to go to break. But that's a question that I could ask, that I could answer more fully if you'd like.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay. So why don't we hop into the break now? All right. So hang in, everyone. We'll be right back right after this break.
All right, we're clear, Martin. 4 minutes, brother.
We got 4 minutes, okay.
Great, okay.
All right, so let me just get this going here. And so you said that you grew up, but I will edit that out. And I just got to make a note of where it is in the show time. Okay. All right, anyway. So you grew up in the Folsom Lake area?
Yes.
And so there are a lot of things going on there.
Yeah, there's a study that's ongoing since I think the 70s or 80s of people who have had experiences there. Yes.
Wow. And what type? Are we talking about, just UFO sightings or more than that?
No, unfortunately, we're talking about more than that. We're talking about people who have had direct C3, I guess, type episodes, and sometimes being injured, and sometimes wow. Surviving their injuries. Yeah. Uh-huh.
And are these a lot of times, I'm sure, since you've looked at, you know, this topic quite a bit. You know that a lot of people have repeat experiences of things going on.
They've had repeat experiences. Uh-huh. Yeah. So it seems like that's a very hot region that people don't know about, and maybe for purposefully, intentionally, they don't know about it.
Yeah. So is this actually part of the Sierra?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. That's so beautiful there.
I love it. Yeah. I miss it.
Yeah, I bet you do. but it's funny. I've never really, I had moved out of Lake Tahoe when I had my UFO experience. So I didn't really pay attention to the topic when I was there, you know, if things were actually happening in that region. But I know, you know, of course, California is the top UFO sightings in the country. Of course, you know, a lot of it has to do with population and the good weather as well.
Yeah, yeah, that's true. You can see a lot.
Right. Yeah, yeah. All right, we got 1 minute left to this break. And so as far as the area there, are there also like sightings that you know of, like that people actually see the craft or lights or?
Yes. They see kind of like the plasma craft.
Oh, like the orbs or whatever?
Yeah, but much larger than they generally are. You know, they look like crafts, but they look like plasma crafts, kind of orange colored.
Yeah, yeah. There was someone doing research through MUFON that, and he was just focusing on the orange, you know, he called them orange orbs, but that was his total focus. He was on the show at one time and looking into that. Race, are we about ready to go back?
Got about 50 seconds.
50 seconds? Okay. All right. And anything else, or is it basically they're seeing more or less the same type of thing there?
No, I could tell you more, but I can't actually say.
You can't what?
I can't actually say.
Yeah.
What more there is? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Well, I do know that. I was trying to think of where it was. I think it was the Marin County. There's someone I've been in touch with out there. That's the area that I lived in when I was, for the most part of the 9 years that I lived out there. But I'm in touch with someone now that they're saying there's still a lot of activity going all the way up to, you know, all the way north to the Oregon.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So really something else. Here we go. We're about ready, Race?
We're all set. Are you guys all set? Diane, you good?
I'm good.
All right, here we go, Martin. In 5, 4, 3, 2.
All right, welcome back. My guest tonight is Diana Pasulka. And just before we went into break, we were talking about meta-experiencers. And you were talking about Jacques Vallée, and very interesting. You actually got to know him. He is, I'm sure you know, he's an iconic person when it comes to this topic in general.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. He's iconic in general.
Yeah, that's right. He is. He is in many ways. Yes.
Yeah.
And my friend Lee Spiegel's show is going live. I believe it's, I want to say it's August 1st or August 4th. Let me just take a look at the calendar. And that's going to be his first guest on the show.
That's great. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. I believe it is August 1st. He's going to be coming up, Lee Spiegel. So everyone should pay attention to that night. It should be a really great show. Yeah, I did get to meet him. Boy, is he tall.
Yes, he's tall.
Yeah, and very nice. And had a nice, really nice conversation with him. And I like the fact that, you know, his attitude after all these years is, you know, basically we still have no idea, or it could be many things.
Yeah, yeah. I tend to think that it is many things, frankly.
Yeah. And how do you approach that?
Okay. So, I mean, if you think about it, well, first let's get back to your question about how is this kind of like a religion?
Yeah. Oh, yes. Right.
If that's all right.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Okay. So, basically we tend to think here in the United States of religions as the kinds of, you know, if it doesn't look like the kinds of religions of which we are familiar, which are the Western types of religions, you know, Christianity or Judaism, they don't have a God, And, you know, we tend to think, well, I don't see the correlation between UFO belief in UFOs and religion. And I always like to respond to that like I do with my students. You know, if you knew, there are thousands of religions, and there many of them, they don't even look like each other. If you took Christian religions, they don't look like each other, okay? Lots of, like Catholicism, when I first got to the South, a lot of my students didn't know that Catholics were Christians. And I had to kind of do a timeline and show, you know, well, actually, you know. So look at Buddhism, like Zen Buddhism. It's basically, there's no God, and they want you to get rid of any concept or even religious dogma. So, you know, so religions don't look like each other, but what do they have in common? Well, a lot of things that they have in common is they try to answer the big questions about our place in the universe, our places in the cosmos. And a lot of times what you have in religions are beings from the sky coming down and meeting with humans, like non-human intelligence coming down from the sky, sometimes in a vehicle, sometimes not with wings, sometimes with no wings. And they somehow impart to us wisdom, technology, ways of being, and things like that. So if you take religion in that most very basic form, that's what we're seeing here. It's also mythology, you know, the myth of Prometheus, right? So Prometheus is this immortal, he's not a god, he's like a god person. He's a titan, and he gives humans technology and then gets horribly punished for it, right? So what we're seeing here is we're seeing kind of like this mythology that is now in my, and what surprised me most about what I was doing was that I was actually meeting people who were actually creating this technology. So it wasn't really a myth anymore. And I thought, well, this is the weirdest thing I've ever studied in my life, because, you know, if you look at what I've published, it's all, you can look at it and say, surely that's just, you know, what they thought at the time. But you can't say that now, because we're actually living within the technologies that these people are creating. Now, whether or not their belief system is accurate, that this is non-human intelligence, in fact, is beside the point. The point is that this type of religiosity is affecting, you know, is it's effectual, it's creating the types of environment with which we live. So there's this give and take of this religion, not to mention that there are also sightings that we can't identify. And there are also people like the chief of NASA, I think it's Ellis Sofon, but I'm not quite sure. She's still she was a couple years ago. And she comes on the TV and she says, we will find life. We will do it within 20 years. We have the technology to do it. Now, a lot of people, you know, she's not talking about like grays or little green men, or she's talking about like microbes or microbial life or something like that on other planets. But most people don't interpret her as saying that. They interpret her as saying, we are going to find intelligent life. And so there's a bite to this new form of religiosity that's quite different from the old forms of religion of the past. So, you know, so, but I mean, the people that I met various people from different types of sectors of society. I met people who were in programs. I've met people who were academics who had been recruited into programs. And I met academics who were studying just like me. And what they were studying was of interest to like Hal Puthoff or people like that, you know, people from Bigelow's. You know, he has like a crew of scientists. People from his crew would contact us. And so we were just as interested in them, you know, as they were interested in what we were doing as well. So it was kind of this mutual kind of, what do you know kind of thing.
Wow. Do you think that if right now we suddenly had 100% evidence, say, that we have been visited, or that we are being visited from another, by another intelligence from another planet outside of the solar system or whatever, do you think that would actually shape religion or change religions?
Yes, that's a really good question. So I have a friend named Jeff Kripal at Rice University, and he's been studying this for a long time. And we differ on this, or at least we differ on this from the last time I talked to him, which is probably about 2 months ago. And so he thinks that it would change everything about religions, and religions would undergo a complete, I wouldn't say breakdown, but they would be manifestly different. I tend to think that religions have already incorporated the idea of invisible entities and non-human intelligences already. And I know for a fact within the Catholic Church, I've been to the Vatican, I've talked to people there, that many, many people in high up positions in the Vatican absolutely believe in ETs. And that's just a fact. Now, is it a Catholic doctrine? No. Or, you know, will they soon make it one? Probably not. It takes them a long time to make any kind of doctrine. So so I don't think that it's going to impact religions at all. In fact, I think that a lot of people already believe, and I don't think that it's going to, you know, I mean, how it's shaped and what, you know, what we think about it is much more interesting to me, I think, because, you know, a lot of people have these experiences, but like I show in my book, especially say with Ray Hernandez, these experiences get mediated completely and sometimes the very opposite of how these people have experienced them. And that's how they're projected to the population. So a lot of times the population, you know, will go on TV and think that's what an alien looks like or something like that. Well, how would we know what an alien looks like, right? So especially if you get the original person saying, no, that's not really how it was. Case in point, I actually did some interviews with people who had interviewed with John Mack and were mm-hmm. in his book. And so one of the people was Edward Carlos, and he was a professor of art in Tennessee. And so he had to co-author his own chapter with John, for the reason being that John kept calling it an abduction. And Carlos said, it's not an abduction. I feel as if it is an experience. And I feel that it is not, I don't feel abducted in any way. It's not violent. So abduction to him was a very violent term. And he felt that it was, he actually, when I went and talked to him, I spent a whole weekend with his wife and him. And he's an artist. He has really beautiful art. And a lot of it has like, is all inspired by his experiences. Hmm. And so it's really beautiful and expensive. But, you know, I mean, the thing is that his experiences then became abduction experiences because they were in John Mack's book, and John Mack's book then became a New York Times bestseller. And then that created the idea that people have of abduction, right? So, I mean, what I'm trying to also say in my book is that every religion gets mediated that way. Like Christianity is mediated that way. Judaism was mediated that way. So there are people with these experiences. They have these experiences. They tell other people. Other people write them down. A lot of times they write them down and they get it wrong, and then it gets reinterpreted. And then somehow, you know, if you get media involved, like today's media, it, you know, I learned this in The Conjuring, working as the history consultant on the first Conjuring. What happens is that the actual experience is completely different than what really did happen. And why? Because it sells more if it goes, you know, if you do it this way. If you just do it differently, then, you know, like Ray Hernandez's experience was positive, he felt. However, it was promoted as negative, and that's a big difference.
Wow. Wow. This is really fascinating. And I'm sure you've heard of the Fatima.
Yes.
And have you done any research into that in particular?
I actually write about it in my book.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. That was a fascinating situation. And can you just, in a nutshell, some people out there, there's a lot of new listeners to the show, actually, if you wouldn't mind just kind of tell the story a little bit in that as much as you can.
Oh, absolutely. So Fatima is, so there are a whole, what I would call, there's a genre of apparitions of the Virgin Mary within the Catholic tradition, and they're called the Blessed Virgin Mary apparitions. And I actually just, somebody, David Metcalf actually just sent me a really cool art piece of the Virgin Mary as an astronaut, and I thought that was really neat. So, so Fatima is, so let me talk about Catholic experiences in general, if I may, only because that's what, you know, that's kind of what I do. Mm-hmm. So I take Fatima in my book, And what I do is I break it, I look at the original sources, and the original, and when you look at the original sources of a lot of these, and I think actually the best example of this, and I do this too in the book, is the Teresa of Avila experience of, because a lot of people go to Rome and they've seen this statue of Teresa of Avila, who's this nun, the 16th century nun, and what happens is that there's a statue of her in Rome, and it's a very famous statue by this artist named Bernini. And it shows her, and she's in ecstasy, and it shows a little angel, like a cherubic angel next to her with a dart, okay? So when I first recognized that the Catholic tradition had a lot of aerial phenomena and strange beings, I started to look at the original sources of these and interpret them from the original languages. And so I looked at, she actually writes about this in her diary, and any one of your listeners can go out and read it for themselves. It's translated well into English, and it's Spanish. And so basically what she says is, she says this. It doesn't look anything, by the way. This is how it gets completely mediated. And the Fatima miracles and almost all the Virgin Mary apparitions follow the same pattern. And this is the pattern. So she has this experience, and she is not necessarily, I hate to say this, not necessarily at the time of a particularly holy person. And she has this experience, and she says, I usually see angels, but they're in my imagination. And they usually look like what I consider to be angels, which are, you know, big beings with wings. But instead, I see a short, shiny thing next to me, and it's actually not in my imagination. It's actually real. It's fleshy. And I can touch it. And instead of touching it, what it does is it takes this what you would call kind of like a dart or something like that. And how would I put it in a nice way? I mean, you know, it basically it examines her bowels, right? And so she's
it's as nice as you can put it, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it's a, you know, and she says that it's a weird, you know, she says that it's at the same time really amazing and really horrible at the same time. Okay, very similar to what you see in, say, Whitley Strieber's, mm-hmm. you know, and also in John Mack's books and things like that. So if you read it, and then you look at the Bernini statue, which is how people encounter that experience of hers, you can see there's a huge difference, right? Mm. And so then you see that the difference, the original source looks much more similar to what we would call today a quote-unquote UFO experience. That does not mean it's a UFO experience. I don't know what it is. I go with Jacques Vallée. I call it the phenomena. It's a phenomena that's odd, and there are patterns that you can see back, you know, hundreds of years ago, and you can still see it today. And so what is that phenomena? Well, that's the question, right? Does it still happen? Yes. Does it get completely mediated through culture so it becomes something completely different? Absolutely. More so than it did before? Probably the same. That's what I would say. Hmm. So the Fatima, you know, if you look at the Fatima miracle, where a lot of people, so, you know, three kids first see something that looks like it's flying along on a cloud or a disc, and it turns out to be what they think is an angel. And it announces to them that they're going to see something in the future. It's going to be this lady, right? And so they never actually call her the Virgin Mary, but this lady comes down, and there's this buzzing sound, and I talk a lot about it because it has a lot of the elements that people talk about today: the buzzing sounds, the inability to, you know, the feeling of not really being, you know, being kind of like underwater, and kind of, you know, everything slows down. And the strange thing about this, though, is that people actually do see. This being announces to the children that it will appear to a lot of people. And so that all these people start to come, and
thousands.
Mm. Yes, exactly. And it's documented, and you could go online and see this, and you could see the pictures of it. There's an atheist there who writes a commentary on it, and I actually quote him in my book, and he says that I saw the sun. Everybody saw things. Some people saw the same things, and many people saw things that were different. But what was absolutely the case was that it had rained and then everybody was dry. And then they saw what in the Catholic tradition, people call the miracle of the sun, where the sun looked like it was a big flying disc falling to the earth. And the Catholic Church took a while to, you know, determine whether or not this was worthy of belief. And they believed that something supernatural did happen. And that's how Fatima was created, this idea of the Virgin Mary and Fatima. But many people, there is a book that's all about this, and it's written in Spanish. And I note it in my book. It's in my bibliography. And Jacques Vallée has written about this, and Jeff Kripal has written about this. So there are people who've written about the Fatima, quote-unquote, miracle of the sun and things like that.
So was it actually the Catholic Church that kind of changed it into like more of a religious happening, you know, the Virgin Mary and all that, or was someone else calling or just assuming that it was the Virgin Mary?
Well, you know, that's a really good question. That kind of puts a lot of agency, you know, and kind of, you know, what are we going to call it, right? Are we going to call it the UFO Virgin Mary event? You know, we don't know. You know, I mean, I think what it was that a lot of people found this to be a supernatural event that caused them to, and most of them were Catholic, okay, because that's one of the most Catholic countries in the world. And so, of course, they're going to see it through, you know, they're going to see this as a Catholic miracle. And there's no doubt it was, something that defied normal laws of what people see normally. People who didn't believe saw it. So the Catholic Church deemed it worthy of belief. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean the Catholic Church created the belief? I think that to assign, quote unquote, I mean, that's kind of almost like assigning blame. I think that there isn't really, it's a process, Martin, is what I think it is. It's a process that takes place, and it doesn't necessarily take place intentionally by people. Although with the UFO, with UFO narratives, it certainly does. It certainly has. And I do mention that, like with Project Blue Book, and, you know, a lot of the narrative has been, quote unquote, like Robbie Graham has said, managed. And, you know, that's a managed, we've got here a managed narrative. And what I'm basically saying is that there have been managed narratives in the past of, you know, Christianity is a classic example. So, you know, there's been managed narratives of the early Christian church that a lot of people in my field just take for granted. Bart Ehrman writes a lot about it, you know, how Jesus became, you know, Jesus. I happen to be Catholic, by the way, so, but could very well be excommunicated at any time. I don't think it's going to happen, though, because there's a lot of leeway in belief that the Catholic Church allows for. And I think that that's why if it was indisputable that ET is here, that a lot of religions would just accept that.
I think you're right. And also, I have mentioned on this show over the last several years, things, you know, little bits of news from the Catholic Church, for instance, that something about there's possibly intelligent life out there and that we should baptize them or something like that. Did you hear that one?
Yeah, yeah.
And there's been a few other things. And also the observatory and with the canon priests of the astronomers, they're very interested in this whole thing, which is fascinating.
Martin, you know I went there, right?
Oh, no, you did. No, yeah, I didn't know you went there. Yeah, no. Yeah. I have not read your book.
You have to read my book before you invite me on your show.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
Okay, no, that's okay. So I end with I know Brother Guy. Brother Guy Consolmagno is the one who wrote the book called Would You Baptize an E.T.? Okay. And he's a Jesuit monk, right? And an astronomer. And he is now the director of the Vatican Observatory. And so I met him through a friend of mine, Sister Rose, who I work with here on campus. And so he came here, and I didn't mean to call you out there or anything like that.
I deserve it. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So, but I do know a bit about this. So he came out here a couple of years ago, and we were, you know, he had, I said to him, where is, you know, I'm a historian, I want to look through archives. I said, where are all the space, you know, everything that has to do with space and the Catholic history, where is that? Is that at the Vatican Secret Archive? And he said, no, that's actually at the observatory, which is in Castle Gandolfo. And I said, wow. I said, can I come see that sometime? And he said, anytime you want, we have a place there for scholars. You can stay there as long as you want, and I'll give you the keys to the archive, and you know, wow. And you can stay there. So I took him up on his offer, and I took a colleague of mine from the space program, the American space program, with me. And so what we did was we went up there and we looked through, you know, original Keplers, and I actually lost one and then found it, and that caused quite a stir. And but we also looked through the, you know, they have a whole wall that's called ET, that's devoted to search for extraterrestrial life. And that was fast. So, of course, I started there. And I went back and looked at everything. And it was really interesting. And this is the most interesting thing that I found. I found this. And this could be a conspiracy in and of itself. So there is a lot of money given by the federal government openly to universities like Harvard and MIT to study this up until about, like, it looks like around the 1980s. Hmm. And then, and this was to look for intelligent life, non-human life out there, right? ET intelligent life. And then it just stops. And then there's this big gap. And then it goes into like microbiology type things, right? Like, let's study, you know, things that are not intelligent, but things that are. So I thought that was really interesting. I was like, that's a big gap. And so I just took note of it. I don't know quite what to make of it, but my friend had his own theory, which I won't say, but, you know, what happened in the 1980s. So, you know, is what he would ask me. And so we did. And by the way, you talking about people, you'd like to ride one of these spaceships and look, you know, look at the Earth through the spaceship and everything. Strangely enough, I was there and I was at the Vatican Secret Archive actually to study the case of a Spanish nun who believed that she traveled in space on the wings, quote unquote, of angels over to New Mexico and evangelized the Native Americans there, the indigenous population there. And she traveled and she believed that she saw the earth spinning, and she, and her first book was a cosmography for, she called it, I forgot exactly the name of it, but it was basically a cosmography of the earth from space. Which was kind of interesting, yeah. So talk about the remote viewing thing. So she, I would call her a proto remote viewer.
How about that? Isn't that something? We are actually right at break time. So we will jump back and continue our discussion here in just a couple of minutes. So hang in, everyone. This is Martin Willis. My guest tonight is Diana Pasulka. And we'll be back right after these messages. This is Martin Willis. And my guest is Diana Pasulka. And before we get cranking, Race, you said you had, Race is at KGRA Radio, and he has a quick announcement. Race, go ahead and make that if you would.
Yeah, I want to make a big announcement that next week we will be rolling out our high definition phone lines for Martin and the rest of the KGRA hosting staff here on the station. So we can kind of prevent all these little hiccups that we've had in the past and all the different Skype issues that we've had. We're not going to have those anymore. We've got really nice industry standard, high definition phone lines that we're going to roll out next week. So I want you to get your phones out. Save this number, 85-KGRA Live. That's 855-472-5483. And this year, these phones are sponsored by the Paranormal Radio app. And you can also go to Android, the Google Play and iTunes App Store and pick it up, pick up the Paranormal Radio app. It's free, and it's going to be where you can find the best in paranormal talk radio, KGRA, right there very easily. The number, 85-KGRA Live. It's real easy to remember. And save it, because you're going to be able to not only call in and interact with Martin and his guests every week, but you also need to listen for your cue to call in and win really cool stuff from the station as well. And all summer long, all year long, in fact, we're going to have DVDs and CDs. We're going to be giving away, Martin, on your show and on Lee's show, copies of Lee's CD from CBS Radio.
Right.
And books and tickets to all your favorite conferences, expos, and symposiums. So it's going to be a lot of fun.
All right, Race. Thank you. Hey, do I owe you anything? That was quite a little commercial.
No. I probably owe you money for that.
All right.
Thanks, very good. Martin.
All right. Thank you. All right. So getting back to where we were when we're kind of like ending the conversation there when we went to break. And I know that for something I watched that you were being interviewed on, you talked about artifacts. And
yes.
You actually talked about making a trip with someone. Did I remember you saying you were blindfolded and all that?
Yeah.
Oh, can you tell that story? That sounds fantastic.
Yeah. So when I first got into the study, it was late 2011, 2012. And I quickly recognized that there were people other than normal experiencers that were around the experiencers, and they were these scientists that were studying the experiencers so that they could use the technology, use, you know, whatever they were getting from them for their own technologies. And a lot of these people were actually quite successful. And one of them was a person that I call in my book, Tyler. And Tyler is quite an unusual individual. And in fact, there are a few people like Tyler that I met. And Tyler was the most forthcoming with his information for me. And at first, I had heard a lot about Tyler, that he flew around in jets and, you know, he was really wealthy and he studied this as a hobby and stuff like that. And maybe he had these, you know, he worked for the space program. He worked on space shuttles, most of them actually. So, yeah. And so I guess he's actually around your age, Martin. And so he had seen, you know, he had had friends in the Challenger, you know.
Oh, boy.
And witnessed that. Yeah, it was really tragic. And so, but to tell you the truth, I was quite suspicious and didn't really want anything to do with people who I thought were part of, you know, I'm in religious studies. I'm not, I don't want to get into any kind of trouble or anything like that. So I just kind of kept Tyler at a distance, and we had an email correspondence for about a year and a half. And he was interested in a lot of my research because apparently a mentor of his told him that the next, he studied physical artifacts, and the next level of information about the UFO technology was going to involve basically a form of mysticism, kind of like human technology interaction and interface. And since that's what I'd been writing about, I was getting a lot of scientists, like I said, you know, some of the scientists from these people that do this were asking me for copies of my articles, which I would provide to them. And I thought, what is going on? And so I was really suspicious of Tyler. And finally, he said, you're doing a lot of really good work in terms of this historical scholarship, but I'd like you to actually see for yourself that there is actually physical evidence, and you'd have to go to a UFO crash site in New Mexico. And I said, is this going to be Roswell or something like that? I was very, you know, basically skeptical. And he said, no, he said in 1947, oh, is this really UFO day, by the way? Cause I didn't know it was.
I didn't know.
So if that's the case, that would have been in 1947. So this is really cool. And by the way, my own university was founded in 1947. So there's some synchronicities for you. So yeah. Anyway, yeah. So there were apparently several crash sites in the 47, right? And this was one of them, but it was highly, no one went there, okay? And it was, if I went there, I would have to be blindfolded. Well, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to go with this man. I did meet Tyler. I had Jeff Kripal meet him with me, and he seemed like a good family man, incredibly charismatic, obviously wealthy. He was wearing Gucci, you know, and everything. And I mean, you know, this is not your typical kind of guy. And so I still was not going to go to New Mexico blindfolded with him unless I had a friend. Mm-hmm. So I first thought of Jeff, and I said, you know, will you go with me? And Jeff said, you know, Diana, he said, I would love to go with you, but this is really out of my comfort zone, and no. And I said, Jeff, please, you know, someone's got to go with me. I really want to go. This now I won't want to go. So I asked a scientist that I knew who is a renowned scientist. And I would say that he's passionate. This is his passion, is to study the phenomenon. And he's a good friend of Jacques. And so he said, yes, I'll go like that in a second. So I told Tyler, you know, hey, can this guy go with us? And I knew that Tyler would Google him and see that he should go, because if anybody could help understand these artifacts, it was going to be that scientist, who I call James in my book. And so Tyler at first said no, and said, I have to get permission to go to this site, and this happens, and no. And so I just waited, and I told James, let's just wait. So we waited, and within 2 days, Tyler got back to us, and we went. So we went to New Mexico. We stayed at this place, and it was quite eerie. It was a very, you know, we had to wear special clothes because there would be rattlesnakes, and it was going to be really hot, but there was this wind, and we were going to, you know, get sunburned. And so, you know, so we went there. And Tyler had special metal detectors that were configured for the types of things that we were looking for. They were not normal metal detectors. And so we spent all day out there, and we did find some things. And I trusted James. You see, James is an academic, and he and I have the same, Tyler's not an academic, right? And so his worldview is completely different than James and I's. And you know, so we would confer. We would, you know, Tyler would be looking, and we would say, are we being set up? Is this like, you know, some kind of, is he planting these things for us to find? So we did find some artifacts, and we took them back. Tyler just goes through airport security. He doesn't have to go through airport security. He just, like, he's got some, you know, he's above that. So James and I have to go through airport security. And so we go through I don't have the pieces. I'm like, they're yours, friend. So he takes them, and he gets stopped, right? And Tyler's just hanging out, you know, looking. And I come and I sit down next to Tyler, and I'm worried. And he says, don't worry about it. He goes, it's all good. He goes, he's going to be fine. And so he comes out, and James is sweating and everything like that. And so, yeah, so that's the opening of the book, is me kind of going to this place, and also linking it to the X-Files, because at one point when I take my blindfold off, I'm looking around, and I keep looking at this one plateau, and Tyler's looking at me, look at the plateau, and finally he says, do you recognize that? And I said, I've never been here before. How would I know? And he said, that's in the first episode of the latest X-Files. And I was like, oh, this is so weird, because yes, this is exactly what my book is about how this type of contact experience, this type of experience becomes a mythology for millions of people. Of course, it's going to be in the episode of the X-Files.
Wow. So tell us about the artifacts. What were they, or were they studied or looked at? And what were these objects? I mean, were they actual, like, look like pieces of metal, or what were they?
Okay, so there were two types of artifacts. I can only talk about one type. They are being studied, and the study is ongoing. And I believe probably some of the people that you've mentioned have access to some of these artifacts as well. And a lot of scientists know that they are anomalous, like they just don't know what they are, how they were created. And these are people that are, you know, they are not, let's put it this way, these are top scientists, like of top research universities in the world. So, you know, when people ask me, is this true about something that I wrote, I will give them the source, and I will say, yes, this is, I'm not making it up. This is a true thing that was found. So, you know, I trust these scientists, and we have what's called peer review. So it's not just one of them saying, oh, this can't have been made in the universe. This is these are many scientists that are saying this about these parts. Now, what do we make of that? I don't have the, that's above my pay grade, right? To say, I don't know. All I know is that the scientists are compelled by them to study them. There have been some strange, what you would call kind of almost synchronistic, psychic, strange things happen with the parts. So, you know, in many ways, it's like a religious relic. That's what I call it in my book. I say, you know, if there are religious relics for the UFO new religion, these would be them, the parts, the relics. And if we could actually back engineer things from them and create biotechnologies, I mean, that's a very strange new religion.
Are they considering them like metamaterials or something?
Yeah. Some of the scientists call them metamaterials, yes.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I would think that if Tyler can bring you to this place, he can't be the only one that knows it exists. And if that's the case, why aren't there people out there scouring for whatever else they can find? I mean, if you found a couple of objects in, you know, one afternoon, there must be a lot more pieces available. Is there anyone ever talking about that?
Yeah, definitely. Other people that I know have gone to the place. The place is actually owned by a private citizen, and mm-hmm. it's on. So I can't say too much about it because, you know, you have to understand, and I don't want people to get angry with me about this, but I was able to do this research, getting the trust, you know, forging trust relationships with people whose names and locations I promise not to reveal. And other people do know who these people are and that they've verified them. And I'm not, you know, my reputation is at stake here, you know, so I'm not making it up, but I can't say where the place is, nor can I say that, you know, that the owners just don't want a Roswell around their place. You know, they don't want it to be kind of like a circus, yeah. Basically.
Yeah, and that has happened. I'm sure you've heard about situations like that, considering like the Skinwalker Ranch. I'm sure,
yes.
You know,
yeah.
That is, there's people trying to get in there constantly, and they actually have to have a guard there and all that. Yeah, so... and people will drive, you know, they'll come from different countries to, you know, if they know where a location is. So I understand why they're hiding it and not making it, you know, a public access. Definitely.
Well, you know,
makes sense.
It's not just that. I think that if Alejandro has said earlier, you know, if governments like military institutions like the Navy are interested in what's happening here, you've got to be sure that other governments are interested in what's happening here too. And so if it's a, you know, if this is a case of national security, then that's why I was suspicious and cautious. And that's why I'm basically saying I'm in recovery from my book, you know, from writing my book, because I'm not kidding. I mean, it's not a matter of, this is a matter of, if there are things like Eric Davis says, flying around in the sky, this is a matter of national security. And if there are objects that are from these kinds of things, you better believe that, you know, people from other countries are going to want to know what they are to study them too. So do I want any part of that in my life now? No, I don't. Because I saw the stakes are high. I don't want to be that, you know, I don't want to be involved in something that could cause harm to other people, harm to me. And I was just doing my job, basically writing about what was happening. It's an academic book, you know. Mm-hmm. I never expected it to kind of go into mainstream, which it has, you know. Mm-hmm. But I guess it's because the topic is so topical, right? It's in the media everywhere now.
That's right.
And so lots of people are interested.
Going back to the material, it just makes me a couple things. Like if I was told, like if a Tyler, you know, flew me to a place and I had to do the blindfold and all that, I don't blame you for bringing someone else with you. But if someone gave me a metal detector and said, this will detect other types of metals or something like that, first of all, I'd be very skeptical right then and there. I mean,
yes.
I don't even know if such a thing exists, or maybe it does. But I want to know if you can, you said one of the materials you can't talk about it. Can you, first of all, say why? And then the material that you can talk about, can you describe it more? I'm just kind of interested in shape and what it looked like when you actually held it in front of you.
I've seen the first type of material in some YouTube videos of people who have found similar types of things in New Mexico. And it looks like, it kind of looks like tinfoil frog skin type stuff. It looks like metallic frog skin is what it looks like. And the other type of thing is much more complex. And so, but the first thing, you can actually do some Google searching and find it. And I've seen videos of it. And so I know that it's out there. I know people are looking at it, but I just don't think a lot of, you know, we just right now, I mean, from my perspective, there could be people who know that what it is. I've not met those people. Mm-hmm. I do know that the people that I've met have it been in, like, I call it inspiration. I don't know exactly what they're doing. They have their own labs, you know, so they're creating technologies that are actually viable, working technologies that are actually helping humans. And they are, I call it in my book, I call it inspiration. Because I honestly don't know how they're doing it. I've read their patents. I don't understand a word of them. There are many of those patents out there. And so I would say that at the end of my book, I remain skeptical. You know, I say, I don't know. You know, I don't, I'm a scholar of religion. I've made the case that this is a new form of religion. I'm okay with that. Like, that's what I set out to do. I did it. This, all the stuff that comes with it, all the other stuff, I mention it. I talk about it. I talk about the synchronicities that happened, and the, you know, every person had synchronicities in the book, so I needed to talk about that. I delved into it, and it remained to me something that I'm convinced, you know, like the work of Leslie King, you know, convinced that there's this, there's something, we all know it. I don't think a lot of, you know, I think that there are a lot of pieces that people aren't talking about, which is, again, why I go back to this idea of the Fight Club. So a lot of people don't remember that movie from the 1990s, but it was this movie that where these people basically had this group, and it was almost like this subterranean underground group, and they would not talk about it, right? They, so you've got these groups that do different types of study of the phenomena, but they cannot talk to each other about it at all. So they're not, so the pieces, you know, I actually at one point I met someone from another country who studied the same thing that this other person studied, and I proposed to introduce them, and the person from our country basically said, oh, if you do that, I'll never talk to you again.
What?
Yeah. And I said, wow, wouldn't you want, you know, don't you think that you could come together and learn more? And of he basically course. Said, that's yeah. what he said. He said, that is exactly what I'm not supposed to do.
That is so bizarre.
I know.
Wow. You know, one of the things, when I first started looking at this topic, I was fascinated because I saw these early Byzantine paintings or that would actually show an object in the sky. And it looked like a UFO, but I understand those have actually been explained why they're in those paintings, and it's not about UFOs. But there are a lot of accounts going back in history and of like angels coming down from the sky and stuff like that. Do you think that there's do you think people are interpreting possibly what they're seeing and what they're seeing today as something similar and just, you know, what's a connection there, if there is any?
Yeah. So this would be like the ancient alien idea, right? You know, that
I've never watched that show, actually. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, that's okay.
Yeah.
I tend not to, too. But it is. It's this idea that back in the day, they called them gods, but actually they're UFOs. But, I mean, the idea is this, is that whatever phenomena is happening, you know, from the skies to humans, can't, you know, we've got to take them on a case-by-case basis and look at them. And if we're going to, you know, if we are going to do an analysis of them and say, you know, that they're similar or something like that, we have to do it responsibly. And I've published an article about doing an analysis of that. And So the question, can you please say your question again? Because I think I just forgot it.
Oh, yeah, more or less. I was just wondering if people made, claims of seeing, like, angels coming down from the sky,
right, yeah.
That type of thing.
Uh-huh. Sure, yeah. So one of the things that I would do would be to examine the different instances. Say, take a text, an ancient text like the Bible, and you look at the different ways in which angels are portrayed in the Bible, and none of them are portrayed in similar ways. So you can't really make a general statement, even though we think we know what angels are and they look like this and everything. If you look at the original sources, like, Jacob in the quote-unquote Hebrew Bible Old Testament is struggling with an angel, and it appears to dislocate his hip, right? So it's kind of like a very violent interaction, nothing that I would want to have happen to me. So, and then, you have this angel that supposedly appears to the Virgin Mary and says, Gabriel, and says, you are with child. And, and the first thing that the angel says to her is, be not afraid. Well, yeah, she's terrified, right? So I don't want an angel experience, frankly, because it's going to be scary for one thing, And so what we tend to think of as angels are these beautiful kinds of things and everything like that. But when people actually, when you go back to the historical record and you look at how people describe their experiences with angels, they're not warm, fuzzy experience.
Hmm. Really? Wow.
Yeah. No, not at all.
Hmm. So there is sort of a similarity in that way that, people are saying, they're scared to death and, it's
terrified.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not just, fighting with these things, right?
Mm.
Mm. At night.
Yeah. Yeah. Most of the experiences are at night, but not all of them.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. I'm going to put the phone number up there if anyone would like to call in, and I'll say that number. And this is the last week we're going to use this number, as you heard at the break. We have a new number coming in. But call in if you'd like. That number is 603-967-4030. And what I'll do is when we don't have the system that we're going to have next week. And so what I'll do is we have someone calling in right now. This will be easy. I don't have to interrupt you. All right, caller, your first name and where are you calling from?
My name is Dave Altman.
Hey, Dave.
Hi, Diana. Thank you so much for coming on.
I'm good.
Yeah.
So I have two listener questions.
Sure.
And then one of my own. Okay, so the two listener questions were, one is, what do you think is going on with Chris Bledsoe and his experiences?
Okay, so... all right. What do I think is going on with Chris Bledsoe and his experiences? That's a pretty big question. So I've known Chris for how long? A long time. I know his whole family. Our families are friends. His son went to my university, and they're a wonderful family. I thank them in my introduction. And so I got to see basically how the experience unfolded for the Bledsoe family. And by the way, when you're talking about his experience, you've got to include his whole family in this, because it's a family experience. I mean, it's happened to, I live close to him. I would take some of my, grad students to see him who were studying the phenomena as well. And he would invite us to sit around his fire. So he would have a fire out in North Carolina, and we sit out there, and there would be orbs and things like that that would show up. And Chris Bledsoe has had so much let's put it this way. It's a very, very complex experience that I was going to actually write about, but decided that I couldn't, because for one thing, there's some things I just can't verify. And on the other hand, there's so much mediation of his experiences through groups that are different groups that he affiliates with, that I decided it was just too complex and possibly even maybe dangerous to do. So I decided not to do that. And he's a very sincere person. And so I hope that answers the question. It's an experience that was it. Let's put it this way. It seemed much easier for me to talk to the scientists than to kind of unravel the Chris Bledsoe experience, because it's so complex, so ongoing, and so incredibly complicated by other groups, many different groups of people. That's too complex for me.
So, Dave, we have some other people trying to call in too, but go ahead and fire off the next question.
Okay, so the next one was, do you feel that there could possibly be an evil race of beings visiting the Earth or live here on Earth?
Yes, okay, so this was a question that actually came up with James and I when we were done with our New Mexico time. And basically his research is, he's searching to, you know, and if anybody could do this, I think James can do it. He's in touch with a lot of people who've had very negative experiences with the phenomena. And Tyler has had only positive experiences with the phenomena. And so we were talking about that. In fact, at one point, just before we went to the site, the night before, James showed Tyler and I a lot of his research, and it frankly terrified me so badly that I had nightmares that night. And then I actually prayed, you know, gosh, I didn't even know what I was praying for, but I was like terrified to go. And so what I did was, we talked about it, and James basically said to me, you know, Diana, if this was 50 years ago or 100 years ago, we would be calling these things demons and angels, you know, kind of like what Jacques Vallée has said, you know, that there are people who have very incredibly negative experiences and people who have incredibly wonderful experiences. So are we talking about the same kind of phenomena? I'm not sure. Are we talking about two different types of the same kind of phenomena? I don't know. So I think that we're just so in the dark, so in the very beginning. We can't even acknowledge publicly that this is happening to us. That's how in the dark we are about this.
Interesting.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Diana. I'll go ahead and I'll hang up, Martin, because you have people calling in, and I'll talk to Diana later.
All right. All right. Thanks for the call.
Okay, bye.
All right. So the number's back up there. I know someone was trying to call in. You're welcome to give us a call back. And wow, that's interesting. I know I've been in touch with Chris lately because he was going to be on the show. I actually met him at a conference, and we recorded a show. And, you know, a lot of people are really skeptical over his situation because he failed a polygraph test. But there's still so many people that visit him, like you just said. John Alexander, who can be very skeptical, was actually telling me some amazing things when he visited there. So yes. we have another caller calling in right now, and I'll take that call. Caller, your first name and where are you calling from?
This is Bobby from North Carolina.
Hey, Bobby. How are you?
I'm
met Bobby
at work.
Years ago. You're at work. Uh-oh. So, hey, you got a question for Diana?
Sure do. I wanted her to speak a little bit about when they had one of the artifacts in Tyler's bag. They spent the night over at a friend's in his house, and
yes.
Then a friend called him later.
Yeah.
And it was a real interesting story. That, and also when he was working in that bunkered room where he felt like there was a presence in there, and it changed the way his brain worked. It actually made him invent things. That's awesome.
Yeah.
And your book is fantastic.
Oh, thanks, Bobby. Yeah, so you picked up on two things that I think are fascinating, and I did want to mention those actually, but we just didn't get the chance. So thank you so much for bringing those up. So
thank you. I'm going to go ahead and take the call off the air.
Yeah, you got to get back to work. Get back to work, Bobby.
Yep.
All right, thank you.
I'm hiding in the closet.
All right. Again, yeah. Okay.
My kind of person. So Tyler. So I mentioned that that one of the artifacts had this kind of quality to it that. And that Tyler himself had mentioned that the next area of study would be some type of interface with the technology or artifacts and things like that, brain-human interface, which is what I've written about before and, in fact, focused most of my work on now. And And so Tyler had this really interesting experience, and I think I write this very at the end of my book, near the conclusion, where basically he has the artifact in his backpack, and he goes and he visits a friend of his, and this is in the Bay Area, and the friend does not know that there's anything in his backpack other than just, you know, stuff you'd have in your backpack, books or whatnot, if you're an academic, you know. And so so they have dinner, they have a good time, and then the next day the friend texts Tyler and basically says, I had a really, really crazy dream about whatever you had in your backpack. And Tyler didn't ever even mention his backpack. Hmm. And he said, I dreamt that there was something in your backpack that was like universes that went all the way down, kind of like, you know, turtles all the way down. Like it was universes upon universes upon universes all the way down. And I thought that was really interesting because Tyler himself believes that human beings are receptors. Like he thinks that what SETI is doing is actually is not going to be successful. Excuse me, SETI, for saying this, but this is not what I'm saying. This is what Tyler says, because he says that we inherently, that our DNA are receptors, and that we actually act as radios, and that we can actually receive and put out information. And so that apparently this is somehow functions like this other artifact. And so I think that this man that he visited, his friend, somehow picked up on that. And it's not just that thing that has that I talk about in the book. And in fact, from the time I ended my book, all of my focus now, I say that I'm recovering from the book, but of course it's just coming at me from every direction now, you know, because I have people from the communities of, you know, the people who study this and had studied it within intelligence communities have been reading what I've written. And now I've had correspondences with some of the people you've mentioned, actually, who talk about what's called neurodigital transfer. And if it's kind of a weird time to be alive, because we're talking about interfacing with technology on a physiological basis. And that has a lot to do with what this artifact is about, I believe. And I also wanted to mention the what happened to Tyler. Tyler said that after the Challenger incident, he felt that first he left the program a bit and then came back. But he was then stationed at a place where there was a concrete building, and I guess the concrete building was trying to either, he said it was either holding something inside of it or keeping something out. He wasn't sure which, but he felt as if somehow there were things that permeated, that there were frequencies that permeated his own body, such that afterwards he had been completely changed and he was a receptor for non-human intelligence. So that's what he said. Yeah.
Wow. Okay. It looks like we have another caller on the line. Caller, your name and where are you calling from?
Hi, my name's Mark. I live in Northern California.
Hi there. I think we have two people on. I'm not sure. So the other person, hang in there if you would. Again, can you say your first name one more time?
Sure. My name is Mark. I live in Northern
California. Mark. I'm sorry.
Hi,
yes.
Mark.
Hi, Mark. Welcome to the show.
Hi.
You have a question for our guest?
I do. Hey, Dr. Pasulka. I wanted to first of all say, I think your book is quite an accomplishment. I've actually read it a couple of times. It's rare some things so thoughtful actually comes across in this field, a book of that nature. So kudos to you.
Thank you.
I did want to tell you, I was just reading the Daily Beast article. I think it just came out yesterday, an interview that you recently did.
Oh, right, and, yeah. You mean the one about Jay Michelson, the one that just came out?
Yeah,
love that one. Yeah, I
was. It was great.
Sorry,
there was this quote from you that they just sort of dropped at the end that is so awesome. You were saying that once you become aware of the phenomena, it becomes aware of you. And I'd love to hear you say a little more about that.
Yeah. Okay. So that, I love that. First of all, you have to understand that I never read my reviews because people can get pretty nasty, and I'm just trying to protect my ego here. Okay. So what happens though is that sometimes a colleague will say to me, and this time I had about 10 different colleagues text me, email me, and say, you've got to read this review of your book in the Daily Beast. And so I read it, and I absolutely loved this review, because that reviewer, I felt, really got it and really understood this, what I was trying to do. Now, that quote is not necessarily my quote, okay? I can't exactly remember who I was quoting, but I did, basically I said, oh, I think it was David Stinnett. David Stinnett is a UFO researcher. I also think he works in biotechnology, actually, but he's in the third chapter, which covers Scott Brown's In the Field UFO group, where he has a bunch of videographers doing capturing captures basically, and also identifying CGI. And so once you become aware of the phenomena, it becomes aware of you. I want to place this within like religious traditions. So once one begins to wake up to, let's take Zen Buddhism as an example. Zen Buddhism, which, by the way, I love this denomination of Buddhism. It's also called Chan Buddhism, which is the Chinese version. And it's basically Taoism and Buddhism meeting together. And it forms this philosophy, really, in which case you're supposed to lose all your preconceptions of things and just deal one-on-one with reality as it is, kind of as it comes at you. And so, really, it's kind of like an anti-religion. It you're losing dogmas, right? And so instead of gaining them, you're losing them. So I believe that when that happens is when your life, when you start to experience these things that people call synchronicities, that where it's almost as if Tyler would talk about how he would get an inspiration, and then he would get validation from the environment that this was something he needed to do. And the validation from the environment, I remember I was talking in class, and I was just about to tell them something that, I'm in the South, so you've got a lot of Southern Baptist people who've, they've not read the text in its original languages. So I'm just about to give them something that's going to upset them, I have a feeling. I'm going to tell them that there are two creation stories in the Hebrew Bible. And just as I say this, I say, I'm going to tell you something, and it might be really upsetting. And then there's this big clap of thunder. And everybody goes, jumps out of their seat, right? So that's kind of like how we wake up. And so I think that that's basically the same, a way of waking us up to reality is not what we think it is. And once we come to that, then reality almost like meets us where we're at and interacts with us. That's my interpretation of it.
Wow. Mark, thanks so much for the call.
Yeah, I just also want to say, I hope you're not so spooked you retire from this topic, because I think you have a lot of insightful things to say. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. That. All right. I think we have a couple of people on the line, so hopefully, let me just see if I can figure out how to make this work smoothly. I don't think I can. So,
hello?
Who's been waiting the longest?
Hello?
Hi there. Your name and where are you calling from? First name.
Hi there. It's James here from Germany.
Germany.
Hi, James.
Hi, Dr. Pasulka.
Wow.
Hi, Dr. Pasulka.
Guten Tag.
I'm a Canadian. Yeah. I have the accent. That's why I don't sound German.
Okay.
I'm a big fan of your book, and it's been really useful for me in introducing the topic to some friends in academia who would otherwise be very skeptical to the entire thing. I wonder how you see your book in context with this current disclosure process, I guess we call it now in ufology. And what's your take on sort of the meta process that's taking place here, where it sort of feels like we're being given the official canon, right?
Yeah.
If this was early Christianity, right, and Constantine has come in now and deployed the official canon, that's how I've interpreted the entire scenario. I wondered your feedback and how you see your book in that process.
Wow, James, what a really great question. Okay, so it was my fear that I would be included in this canon somehow. And so I, as a person who does academic work and tries to describe it instead of, engaged in doing it, I think that this is something we can't avoid. So in the very introduction to my book, I basically say, I'm at this point where I'm almost confirming this myth, which is that we're back engineering things from this technology that we have no idea where it came from, who created it, and that type of thing. And how do I get myself out of that? Well, I had to think about that for a long time, and I had to honestly state in my book, I can't get myself out of that. So I think the first thing we have to do is we have to just say that, we have to honestly say, we don't know what the heck we're doing. Sorry. we are going blindly down a path. And I think that's okay. That's how we'd make progress. Now, this whole disclosure thing. In the very beginning, I was beginning to think that I was part of some type of unofficial disclosure. And because I was being shown things and I was being introduced to people that I shouldn't really know, because I'm a professor of religion and who are these people to want to talk with me? But as I kind of got along, I realized that they were the reasons why they were interested in the work that I do, and not just me, but scholars of religion who have like language training from the Greek tradition and that type of thing, was that they were trying to figure a lot of different things out. One of the things they were trying to figure out was that if these new kind of frequency weapon technologies were around back in the day, because they can find that out through looking at the way the sources are written. And if they were in the back in the day, then we know that there's some type of intelligence that created that. You see what I'm saying? So that's why it's kind of like dangerous territory when you start to bring religion into this complex world of ufology. It's what I would call, the other caller said, don't get too spooked out by it, that you don't pursue it. Well, I can't say I'm there yet, in terms of the whole disclosure thing, it's happening through every way it could possibly happen. My kids have Lego, Legos of alien abduction Legos, right? So...
Wow.
They grew up on it. For my students, I give them surveys in my classes. Their level of understanding, I give them an option. I say, do you believe in ET in the past, ET in the future, ET here now, or no ET, or something like that? And 87%, by and large, are the first three. Like ET in some capacity.
Wow. So do you think that younger people are more apt? It sounds like
I do. And this is why I think that. I give this example a lot. I have students who go to study abroad, and a lot of them go to Italy, and they'll go to Florence, to the museums, or they'll go to the Vatican, and they'll see the what in Catholic tradition is called the stigmata of Francis of Assisi, which are the wounds of Christ on his. And if, for those of you who are not Catholic and don't understand, a lot of times you see Jesus with these wounds on his hands, right? The wounds of Christ. And that in Catholic tradition, that's called the stigmata. And St. Francis was in the 1200s, was the first person to have gotten this. Now, if you see the paintings of this event, which, by the way, there are probably, hundreds of these paintings, and many of them are at the Vatican and in Florence. If you go and you look at these paintings and you're like my students' grandparents, what you see is you see this angel coming down on a cloud-like form that looks somewhat like a magic carpet. And you see this angel throwing light, like golden light, down at St. Francis's hands. And by the way, that day is the day that he's doing that, that he's getting those wounds, is the Feast of the Archangels, strangely enough. So that happens, and the grandparents are going to interpret that as an angel coming down and doing that to St. Francis. Now, my students go, and what do they see? They see a UFO. They see, Dr. Pasulka, did you know that a UFO, like, zapped St. Francis and gave him these wounds? And so they send me these pictures, and I say, well, we can't, it depends on what time frame and, that kind of thing. So younger people are more apt to see these kinds of things as UFOs than older generations of people, absolutely, because of the media. We're primed to see it that way. And by the way, I want to say that I did do an analysis of the St. Francis wounds of Christ, and he actually died from those wounds.
Wow. Thanks so much. Thanks, caller. I think,
thank you.
Yes, and he's gone. And we have another caller on the line, don't we? First name and where are you calling from?
Yes. This is Kevin. I'm calling from Augusta, Georgia.
Hi, Kevin. Thanks welcome to the show.
Kevin.
Hi. Yeah. Hi. Loved your book.
Thank you.
But I'm sort of a lifelong experiencer, but I'm not going to, the details aren't important. But one of the themes, and I was wondering if you've noticed this or it's been part of your study or a pattern that you've seen, is there's a teaching that goes on. And for the most part, I see it revolves around conquering your fears.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if that has come up thematically in any of the work that you've done. That one of the things that I've gotten is that they're trying to help, in my case, me, overcome fear.
Yes. Okay. So this is something that I'm sure you're probably aware of Whitley Strieber's work. And Whitley, I've been on his show a couple times, and Whitley and I also, he's a friend of mine. And Whitley basically believes that, in fact, I did an interview with him that couldn't run because it was so, he had asked such specific questions. And they had to do with the interface between the phenomena and the human being. And the humans are so, like I said about the angels, when people, you know, if you look at the historical record of angel interactions, they're not happy experiences for people. Like, humans are afraid of these things. And even Rainer Rilke, James will know this name from Germany. He's a very famous German poet. And one of his most famous poems is beautiful. One of the lines is, every angel is terrible. Right. So, seriously, these are like scary things. And so I think that fear, Whitley, basically, that's his whole thing, is that they're trying to communicate. They want to communicate, but we're too afraid to communicate. We don't understand their form of language. And so I know Whitley's next book is basically about their form of language and how we can get over our fear. And he says, if we are too afraid to meet with them, this is now Whitley saying this, and Whitley can get on my case if I misquote him. Basically, if we're too afraid, then it's going to not be a good interaction. It's going to be very bad. But if we conquer our fear, it's going to be a helpful, beneficial, mutually beneficial interaction. That's basically what he's saying. That's not what I'm saying, but that's what he's saying. So, yeah.
Well, that's fantastic. In my own experiences, it's oftentimes they'll present themselves as a scary, apparently a monster. But when you look further, you find out, well, no, they're not. They're with their children or something like that. So it's just my perception of it. The situation wasn't truthful. It wasn't accurate. My prejudice, my fear would get in the way, and they were trying to break that down. Okay, that's all. That was my only question, but I appreciate
Can I ask you? Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Okay, so when you say that they were with their children, are you talking about specific types like whites or something like that?
Yeah, well, they don't. I don't. Whatever is going on with me, I don't see gray aliens or anything like that. You can always tell it's the same thing, but it never really presents itself exactly the same. So in this case, it was one instance, it was something that looked it had several different characteristics of several different types of animals put together, and it acted in a certain way that wasn't threatening but was startling. And I was startled, but then when I said, wait a minute, this is the fear thing they're trying to get you through, and I'd look and see, oh, they did that because they're protecting their little three babies, right? Things that we could, so I always find it kind of be metaphorical in the way I get things. And I never really, they'll say to me, that if they ever use language, it'll be like, here, I have a puzzle for you, or you're this, but never anything that's like a complete sentence. You understand what I'm saying? But it comes out through metaphor.
Yeah. Yeah, no, and symbol and stuff like that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's fascinating. Okay. Thanks for sharing.
All right.
Oh, sure. Certainly.
Kevin, thanks for the call. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Bye. All right. Bye. So we only have a couple of minutes left here. And so why don't you tell the listener where they can find your book? It's Amazon. And do you actually... I can't remember. Do you have your own website or do you interact with people?
Yes. Okay. So I do have a website. It's called AmericanCosmic.com. And the book can be, and I have a sign-in sheet there, but I think what happened was once I started to recognize the everything that went along with studying this type of thing, I hesitated to basically, I got off social media and I hesitated to interact because of a lot of problematic things, basically. And so
that's too bad. I understand.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm low key right now. However, that doesn't mean that I'm not working on something, and I am. And also, if people are interested in that, they can sign up for the newsletter, which I basically, I'll send out soon, but I don't send it out now because I'm waiting for kind of like the fallout from this book to kind of, you know, slow down. But also, you can get the book anywhere. I mean, it's on Barnes & Noble. It's on, you know, you can get it on Amazon and Oxford University Press, which is the press that, you know, publishes the book. They sell it as well.
It's good.
And, yeah. So.
Wow. And so, you're working on something else. I can't wait. And I will get this book and I will read it because I think it's it is fascinating.
And thanks, Martin.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's going to be it for our show. And I really do appreciate it. It's been really fascinating. It's really a fascinating topic to begin with. And you've done a very, very nice job with it.
Thank you so much.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much. And good night now.
Okay. Bye.
Bye-bye. All right, everyone. So that's it for this this show. And next week, we have kind of an exciting show because we have Ben Hansen on. He's always a great guest. And he does very few shows these days. And he has a new show. It's actually about ghosts. And we'll talk a little bit about that. And then after that, the second hour, we have Walter Bosley. So it's going to be an excellent show to tune into next week. So don't forget that. I want to thank everyone that helps out with the show. All the people behind the scenes. We have a Facebook page. Go check that out. It's podcast UFO and live shows, I believe it is, on Facebook. And there's new articles going up every single day. Don't forget to check out podcastufo.com and our blogs that are written every week by Charles Lear. And you heard Race talk about the new phone line next week. So that'll be exciting to actually have a screener and figure out how to do it right. Anyway, thanks so much, everyone. And remember to keep your eyes to the sky.